بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank him upon all conditions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us, to grant us goodness and ease. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us during this beautiful eve of the month of Ramadan. Allahumma innaka afuwun تحب العفو فاعف عنا. Oh Allah, you are most forgiving, you love to forgive, so forgive us. Ameen. Brothers and sisters, the status of parents in Islam is extremely high. We all know the value of parents, and we all know that we are taught to respect our parents, to be kind to them, and to obey them within the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا.
Allah has declared that none shall be worshipped besides him, and that you shall do good, or you shall be kind to your parents. This shows us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying he created you and he chose for you a certain passage, a certain means, and this means was your parents. You had no say in it, so it's up to you to obey the instructions of your parents for as long as they do not contradict the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was well known from the very beginning of prophethood. From the beginning of Islam, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to tell those who entered the fold of Islam, you are becoming a Muslim. This does not mean that you cut ties with your family members, you cut ties with your parents. You need to continue being kind to them, looking after them, spending on them, for as long as they do not instruct you to do that which is prohibited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the beautiful stories made mention of in Sahih Muslim as well as Sunan al-Tirmidhi, and it's a narration of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu himself. He says, when I accepted Islam, my mother became so upset, she was so angry, she refused to speak to me, and she said she will not eat or drink until I come back to worshipping the idols that we all used to worship as a family. And that was not an option for him, but he was obviously, he had a feeling for his mother. He was a child who knew the value of a mother even though she was a non-Muslim. And he constantly told her that Islam has taught us to be kind to our parents. So she told him through someone that if Islam has told you to be kind to your parents and to obey your parents, I am telling you, come back to your old faith and start worshiping the idols once again. Up to that point, I'm not going to eat, I'm not going to drink, I'm not going to speak to you, and I'm going to die in this condition perhaps. She wanted to starve herself. So Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu was very concerned. He went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is the crisis that I face. This is the problem and the challenge that I have in my own home. This is what my mother is saying. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed two sets of verses. And before I say these verses, this has happened to more than one companion where they have had to choose between, or they were asked to choose between Allah and the parent, and Islam came in, intervened, gave the direction to say, for a Muslim, there's no choice. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make it easy. So verse number 8 of Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah says,
وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ لِتُشْرِكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا.
Allah has instructed you, O man, to be kind to your parents. Remember kindness. You speak to them, speak with kindness. You need to reach out to them, help them. You may want to spend on them if you have to, perhaps to clothe them, perhaps to feed them at a certain age, because when you were young, they used to look after you. They clothed you, they fed you, they did whatever they had to for you. You cannot deny that, and you cannot just forget about that. You need to give them back with a kind word, a good word. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Luqman, verse number 15. In fact, the same surah, Al-Ankabut, Allah says, if they are striving, if they are trying to make you go back to idol worshipping, or to encourage you to go back to shirk, or to commit association of partnership with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you do not obey their instruction. And in Surah Luqman, verse number 15, there is an addition. Allah says, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Be a good company and companion for them in this world, in accordance with the norms of society. So, you know, looking after your parents in society, subhanallah, it is considered highly valuable. Ask the older people, they will tell you, mashallah, you know, my son looks after me, my daughter looks after me, and so on. And they say it with pride, with tears in their eyes sometimes, because it becomes very, very difficult to look after parents, especially when there is a generation gap, my brothers and sisters, where the thinking changes within the generations. Then it becomes very difficult, because whatever they say at a certain point becomes an irritation for those who are much, much younger. We ask Allah to protect us. So we think, you know what, dad, you want me to look after you, but look at how you're talking. The problem is not what dad is saying. The problem is there is a generation gap now. People's thinking has now slowly changed. We understand that when it comes to Islam, nothing changes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May He make us from those who can respect one another. The problem sometimes is from both sides, not just one side. The parents are not willing to consider or compromise, and the children are also not willing to consider or compromise. So we are stuck and no one wants to move. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May He soften our hearts. May He make us from those who can understand each other. Remember, life is all about give and take. For as long as you are not contradicting the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the rest is minor. If a person wants to live with you, they don't want to live with you, there is nothing farad or haram about that. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for as long as you are taking care of each other, you respect each other, you are kind to each other, by the will of Allah, Allah will be happy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us fulfill the rights of our children as well as the rights of our parents. So these are some of the verses. Do you know what happened? A few days later, she started eating and drinking, because where was she going to go? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May He open our doors. Sometimes there are empty threats that are made in order to divert us from Islam, from the core belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to know that when it comes to prioritizing as a Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is right at the top, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then comes everybody else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. We have a beautiful verse in Surah Luqman as well, which is connected to the unseen. People used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and ask him questions. When is the end of time going to be? So he used to say, the knowledge is with Allah. Then they used to say, so when is it going to rain, and how much is it going to rain, and where is it going to rain? So he would say, the knowledge is with Allah. Then they used to say, so tell us, what is exactly in the womb of the woman who is expecting? He says, the knowledge is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they would say, okay, tell us, what are we going to earn tomorrow? We're going to go out for a business deal to Asham. What are we going to come with, profit or loss? He says, the knowledge is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they would say, okay, tell us, where are we going to die? So he would say, the knowledge is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they used to think to themselves, this man claims to be a prophet. He's supposed to know, minimum he's supposed to know is these things that we've asked him. So in Sahih al-Bukhari, there is a narration of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. He says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once said, مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ خَمْسِ. The keys of the unseen, the main points of the unseen are five. لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. None knows them besides Allah. Allah has kept the knowledge of the following five items with Himself. He has not shared it with anyone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verse number 34 of Surah Luqman. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ
وينزل الغيث ويعلم ما في الأرحام وما تدري نفس ماذا تكسب غدا وما تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت إن الله عليم خبير.
Indeed, with Allah is the knowledge of the hour. The hour here refers to the end of time. When is the trumpet going to be blown? When is everything going to come to an end? Allah says, I've reserved that knowledge with myself. I know, and I've kept it to myself. Then where and how much it is going to rain and what will be the composition of every molecule that will drop from the top. You know that in some places there is acid rain. It is harmful. Some places there is beneficial rain. Some places the droplets are made up, meaning there are larger droplets. Somewhere there is hail, somewhere there is snow. Where exactly it falls, I'm sure you've seen, sometimes as you're driving, it is pouring and you just cross a road and it's as dry as ever, like it hasn't rained at all. Allah knows exactly where every single droplet, H2O, is going to drop on the ground and what is going to be the result of it. This is the entire knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. As the raindrop is coming down, how the wind will blow it and move it and where exactly it will land, Allah says, I've just kept that for myself. Subhanallah. Amazing. So people come and say, well, now, you know, the Met station can tell you where it's going to rain. They give you a rough idea. They are telling you based on perhaps something that is the study of what happened in the past and the study of the movement of the wind and so on. And they're giving you, they may be accurate to a certain extent, but they do not have the exact sound knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. The same applies. Allah says, He is the one who knows what is in the womb. Allah knows. Allah alone knows what is in the womb. So you find the weak people coming along and saying, no, nowadays it's simple. You just have an ultrasound and you know what is in the womb. Tell me, is that child going to be fortunate or unfortunate? Can the ultrasound tell you that? No. Allah says, we know it already in the womb. Tell me the exact composition of the amnion fluid before you actually test it. No one knows. May Allah protect us. There are so many things that we don't know. It's not just gender that is being spoken about. Nowadays, perhaps they might even tell you the color of the eyes. They might want to tamper with it as well. Allah didn't say we know who is in the womb. He says we know what. What refers to absolutely everything put together. How much sustenance this child is going to have. Let's see if machinery can tell us. What is the exact moment of birth, precise nanosecond? No machinery will tell you. You can have a last minute complication and the next thing you know is there is a change in the timing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. So let's not become deceived by technology thinking there is an error in the Quran. Do not try and bring down the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He says, He alone knows what is in the womb. We have translated it as who is in the womb. We have translated it perhaps as a few other things. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, from that womb, we've already written the fortune of the child, the sustenance of the child, the exact point of birth and point of death of the child. Let's see where medicine can come up with that or science. Let's see what apparatus can come and inform us in that regard. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and understanding. So this is the taqdeer that Allah knows. He says, I've kept it for myself. And if Allah has given you the ability to check the gender, perhaps that is Allah who gave you the ability. It does not decrease the knowledge of Allah in any way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Nor is it contradictory to this beautiful verse that happens to be in the Quran. The same applies. What are you going to earn tomorrow? You go on a business trip. What exactly is going to happen? By the end of the day, how much are you going to have in your hand? You might have a guess. You might have a good guess. You might have planned because you know the trend of the graph that perhaps you've drawn. It's a movement in a specific direction. So according to the mean and the statistics, you are working out, for example, what may occur tomorrow or next week. That is only an average. That is only a guess. It may be or it may not be. But we want precise knowledge. Sometimes a person might say, tomorrow I'm going to go out and I'm going to sell this item and I'm going to get 10,000 rands profit and come back. You might be robbed on your way back and the 10,000 is gone. Who told you that by the end of the day you will still have the 10,000? Who knows, the person might have, perhaps something may have happened and they might cancel the deal. Who knows, something else might happen. So the precise sustenance is only known by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may work, you may be getting a salary. You are excited, end of the month, I'm going to pick up my packet. Allah can delay it by a day, 2 days, 5 days. He can cancel it as well. Something can happen and you don't know what came in your direction or what went away. May Allah help us. This is why you ask for children, ask Allah. You ask for pious, good children, ask for Allah. You ask Allah. You ask for good fortune, ask Allah. Happiness, ask Allah. A good death, ask Allah. You don't ask anyone else. This is all only and solely from Allah. You ask for sustenance, you ask Allah and Allah alone, because He is the owner of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand. Similarly, the last thing is, where exactly and when upon the nanosecond that you and I will die, Allah alone knows. So someone says, well, you know what? This guy's going to be shot perhaps at 6 o'clock in the morning by the firing squad because he's been found guilty, death sentence and so on. Do you know what? If Allah wants, it can change. Like I said moments ago, you may have planned something. Whether or not Allah allows the plan to be executed, He alone knows. Some people are on their deathbed. Medicine has told them that finished, you have 2 hours to live. Wallahi, 20 years later, they're still sitting in our midst. Do you know that? That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people think they're going to die, and you know what? They happen to be shifted for some reason to some other area and locality because Allah wrote for them to die there. How many people do you know whom Allah wanted to bless with a beautiful death in Mecca or Medina? They traveled healthy from here. They never came back. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a good death. So Allah says He knows exactly where you're going to die and when. Specific time, specific location, the exact spot and how exactly. Similarly, my brothers and sisters, sometimes we undertake a journey thinking that we're going on holiday, thinking we're going to Mecca or Medina. I'm giving you that example because we would all love to go there. And we don't know, we're actually going to meet the angel of death at the position where we are going or on the road, on the path. This is all part of the knowledge of Allah. Brothers and sisters, call out to Allah for a good death and lead a life in such a way that you have a good death. It is reported that those who lead their lives in a beautiful manner, Allah will grant them a beautiful death, because how you live, that is how you die. And how you die, that is how you will be resurrected. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us improve ourselves. Ameen. Surah Al-Sajda is a beautiful surah. I'm sure a lot of us love to read that surah, and perhaps we know that there is a sajda in that surah. We hear the recitation of it in some of the masajid in Salatul Fajr on a Friday, it being the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this Surah Al-Sajda, it makes mention of a sajda. Sajda meaning prostration in it. The prostration that is engaged in by those who are conscious of Allah, those who love Allah, those who fear Allah. How many of us prostrate for the sake of Allah and take our time in the prostration? To be honest, a lot of us, even in the farad and obligatory prayer, what we do is we pounce onto the ground as though we are feeling some heat on the ground and we need to get our head back up as soon as possible. We are not meant to be like chickens pecking on the ground. No, take your time when it comes to prostration. Shaitan will make your head perhaps pulsate. And at the same time, you might feel a bit of a headache. That is all shaitan. Remember, that is the closest you can ever get to your maker. أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ لِرَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدٌ. The closest you can ever get, a worshipper can ever get to his Rabb, is in the position of sajda. So take your time in sujood. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes those who forsake their beddings in order to praise Allah, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the dark hours of the night. Hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, narrated by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he says, those people who eagerly await Salatul Isha, they are the ones who are described in verse number 16 of Surah Al-Sajda. And other narrations make mention of others who pray at different times of the night. The essence is, you forsake your sides from your beddings. So you don't lie down, you are waiting, sitting. You know this is Allah, I need to fulfill my Salah. Let me give you one example of Salatul Fajr. MashaAllah, we sleep, and you know when the temperature is beautiful, the bedding is cozy, the duvet, MashaAllah, second to none. We have a beautiful mattress that is made of the latest technology and material, the memory foam pillows and what have you, and you are sunk into your bed and you don't want to get up. And then you hear, As-salatu khayrun minan nawm. SubhanAllah. Salah is better than sleep. A true believer is meant to jump up. SubhanAllah. I'm still waiting for someone to invent an alarm which has a spring on your back. As soon as it rings, the spring actually brings you up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Wallahi, that would be the alarm for a believer. You cannot get back until you read your salah. May Allah help us to achieve this. Wallahi, look what Allah says. تَتَجَافَى جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِعِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا. their sides, forsake their beddings, calling out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of fear and hope. How many of us can fit into that verse? And we read Surah Al-Sajdah every week religiously. We hear it a lot. We love it. We want to hear it. The minute you hear Alif Lam Mim in the Fajr, for Jumu'ah, there are two reactions. Some say, MashaAllah, I'm going to hear Surah Sajdah. And the other say, oh no, this is going to be a long rakat. May Allah forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. See, the men know exactly what we're talking about. We need to be from among those who love this. Take your time, it's Allah. When you return to your maker, nothing's going to help you besides the acts of worship that you engaged in, known as your deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us achieve as many deeds as we can while we're alive. What a beautiful verse. Then we have Surah Al-Ahzab. Surah Al-Ahzab is beautiful. It makes mention of so many rules and regulations, and it starts off by speaking about a very important topic. We have something known as adoption. This adoption is a term that sometimes is not understood according to the light shone by the Sharia, by Islam. In Islam, yes, it is encouraged to look after orphans and those perhaps who are in need, and perhaps to reach out to people and to have children who may be homeless and so on, to look after them. But you are never ever allowed to snatch their identity from them, because the identity and lineage is something sacred, chosen by Allah. We started off by saying your parents, chosen by Allah. Nobody can ever hide who your folks are from you. They need to let you know. You will always remain Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, for example. You will always remain Faisal, the son of Ibrahim, for example. That son of will never ever change, no matter what. It will never ever change. Nobody can come and say, from today on, you who is son of Ibrahim will now be known as son of Ismail. Never ever. That is haram. That is a major, major sin. The hadith says, whoever calls someone with a name besides that of their parents, as in son of or daughter of, and then they have another name stuck on, they won't smell the scent of paradise, even though paradise, the scent of it can be smelt from 50 years away. So let's not cheat and deceive when it comes to lineage. So the rules of adoption are very clear when it comes to Surah Al-Ahzab from the very beginning. What happened is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was a youngster who was given to him by his wife Khadija binti Khuwaylid radiallahu anha as a slave. And his name was Zayd ibn Haritha. A little while later, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam freed him, and he happened to be a servant. And sometime later, his parents came, and he chose not to go with his parents, and he chose to stay with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was Zayd ibn Haritha. And what happened is, Zayd ibn Haritha was a man whom, because of his close connection from a very early age to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to be seen walking with him and playing with him and being with him all the time. He was adopted by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They used to call him Zayd ibn Muhammad. Zayd, the son of Muhammad. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verse number 5 of Surah Al-Ahzab, saying, you don't call him Zayd, the son of Muhammad. You call him Zayd, the son of Haritha. Even if you've adopted him, it only means you've looked after him. You cannot snatch the identity or the lineage away from an individual. It is a major, major sin. So Allah says, ادعوهم لآبائهم هو أقسط عند الله. Call them with the lineage connected to their fathers. That is justice. That is the most just in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This hadith is muttafaqun alayhi, hadith of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. He says, we used to call Zayd bin Muhammad. When this verse was revealed, we started calling him Zayd bin Haritha, because we knew it was prohibited. Similarly, the earlier verse, that is verse number 4 of Surah Al-Ahzab. Zayd ibn Haritha later on married a certain female known as Zainab binti Jahsh. She was from a noble tribe and so on, and we will get inshallah in a few moments as to how exactly it happened. At a certain stage, he divorced this woman. And at a certain stage, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam married the woman. So some of the people of the book and some of the others, they said, look at this man. He just married the divorced woman of his own son. Because he used to be called Zayd bin Muhammad, remember? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses actually clarifying that one of the reasons why we instructed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to marry Zainab binti Jahsh is to make it clear that these adopted children are not actually yours. They are just an amana entrusted to you. You can marry their ex-spouses, whereas you can never ever marry the ex-spouse of your father or your son. Never. Subhanallah. So this is not the son of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is why verse number 4 Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلَ أَدْعِيَاءَكُمْ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ. We have never made your adopted children your own sons. They are not your own. So be careful. Now today one might ask that, you know, for purposes of facilitating documentation, perhaps we use the surname in order to make it easy because the child is going to live with us and so on. And I'm sure you're aware of all these new regulations here with the unabridged certificates and so on. You need to move with, even though you are the parents. So when there's a discrepancy in the name, you have a big problem. So some of the scholars have said, for as long as you are not saying so-and-so son of so-and-so and adding your name, to put a surname at the end for purposes of convenience, for as long as the child knows this is not my real father, it's not my real mother. Some people feel hurt. Why should I tell them I'm not the real father, real mother? You're trying to tell me the child is going to live for so long without knowing who their folks are. On the day of judgment, when they are called out, they will be shocked to think that this is my father and I never knew. Who's going to be responsible? Don't be shy. It is something for the sake of Allah. It is not bad. It does not mean you don't love them. I know of a young man who suffered depression because 25 years later, he found out that these are not his folks. When he went to the social services, they told him, we have a clause here stating that it is illegal to let you know who your folks are. And Islam says it is sacred. That is part of your identity. Subhanallah. How can you hide it away? How can you take it away? That's all that's being uttered. So if someone wants to call you daddy, for example, for as long as they know that you're referring to them as a fatherly figure, but not necessarily the particular father, it will be okay. So for as long as there is no deception involved. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May He grant us guidance. This is a powerful ruling. It would never have been made mention of in this beautiful surah if it was not important, my brothers and sisters. Let's take it seriously. Take a look at the marriage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Zainab binti Jahsh. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed Zainab binti Jahsh to marry Zayd ibn Haritha. Listen carefully because I'm going to draw some lessons for us. Zayd ibn Haritha was growing up, young man, and Zainab binti Jahsh, a good-looking woman and, you know, from a noble family, someone who was quite wealthy, and Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I want you to marry Zayd. And she felt in her heart that, you know what, this man is from a poor background, he used to be a slave, he was just freed, now he grew up, yes, and so on. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam read verses that were revealed at the time, verse number 36 of Surah Al-Ahzab. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It is not for a believing male or female, when Allah or His Messenger have decided, declared and dictated something, that they have a choice in that regard. You are a believing male and female, when Allah says something, you feel in your heart, I don't have a choice, I have to get this done. When Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says something, you feel in your heart, I don't have a choice, I have to get this done. Why? Because of the source of the instruction. So that is the verse. Zainab binti Jahsh immediately agreed and said, okay, if that's the case, then I agree. She married him, and sometime later, the marriage didn't work. And obviously this narration is a narration mentioned in Tabarani by Qatada, and another narration of Ibn Abbas mentioned in Tafsir al-Tabari. It is the issue of the marriage of Zainab to Bint Jahsh radiallahu anha to Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anha, and how sometime later it didn't work. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a witness to that. It ended up in divorce, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ended up marrying the same woman, Zainab bint Jahsh radiallahu anha. And like I said, some people said, how could you marry the ex-wife of your own son? And Allah says, that's not his son. We wanted to make it clear that there is actually no blood link between the two. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us, and may He guide us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. I think there are beautiful lessons we've just learned from that. Then we have another beautiful story, muttafaqun alayh, also narrated by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, on a totally different topic, where he says, a relative of mine by the name of Anas ibn al-Nadr, he was unable to participate in the battle of Badr. So later on he regretted a lot, and he promised Allah that if I ever see another battle, I will ensure that I'm in the front line, and I'm going to make sure that I take part in the battle. So later on, when you know the kuffar of Makkah came in close to Medina, and a place known as Uhud, the war took place known as the Battle of Uhud. Anas ibn al-Nadr radiallahu anhu was so excited because he wanted to fulfill the promise he made to Allah at the time of the Battle of Badr. To say, if there's another war, I'm going to make sure I'm there. He was there. And he was so enthusiastic that Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu anhu says, I saw Anas ibn Nadr radiallahu anhu on the day of Uhud. And I told him, I asked him about what's happening. And he says, Wallahi inni la ajidu rihal jannati duna Uhud. He says, Wallahi, O Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, I can smell the scent of paradise before this battle ends. And do you know what happened? He fought, he was martyred. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses in this regard. And this is a hadith, muttafaqun alayh.
من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه.
From among the believers are those who have fulfilled the promise they made to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many of us make promises to Allah regarding minor items, not as big as this, and we never deliver? We say, oh Allah, I'll never commit that sin again. A day later, we're committing it. May Allah forgive us. We say, oh Allah, I'll never miss a salah again. A day later, we've already missed two salah. I'll never ever dress inappropriately again. A week passes and suddenly we give in to the pressure of society and the pressure of the environment and peer pressure. Why don't we please Allah? We promise Allah things when we are in difficult times and we never deliver. I hope we do, inshallah, by the will of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us, inshallah. Tomorrow, I wish to go through more of the verses of Surah Al-Ahzab. What a beautiful surah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us all. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.